মাইকেল নগর শিক্ষানিকেতন হায়ার সেকেন্ডারি গভর্নমেন্ট স্পন্সার্ড কোয়েড ইংলিশ মিডিয়াম স্কুল হ্যাজ টেকেন অ্যান এক্সেলেন্ট ইনিশিয়েটিভ অফ টিচিং অ্যান্ড মেক আওয়ার স্টুডেন্টস লার্ন ডে টু ডে লেসন্স থ্রু অডিও অ্যান্ড ভিডিও ইন আওয়ার ইউটিউব চ্যানেল Teachers of all the subjects are working hard to enhance this online classes in amidst of this pandemic situation. It is a request to all the teachers, students and guardians to click the bell icon and subscribe our channel. Today we are going to start nutrition. Today we are going to do the first chapter of nutrition for class 12. That is the utilization of food by the body. Through the process of digestion. In this chapter, we'll be discussing about digestion and its what it is and what are the different parts of digestion or digestive system and their different functions. So, at first, if I tell you or if I ask you that what is digestion, what is the process? So, in short, we can write it as a definition of digestion. What is that? That is, it is a physicochemical process, right? It is a physicochemical process. Why is it a physicochemical process? Because it involves physical as well as the chemical aspects, which includes the enzymes. So it is a physicochemical process by which what happens? Complex food is broken down into simpler forms or rather assimilable forms with the help of different types of enzymes and digestive juices along the length of the digestive tract or the alimentary canal. So that is the basically the definition of digestion. Now if I tell you, we know this already, so let me just repeat them. We know the different steps about what happens once we eat a food or once we take in food, what kind of things they happen inside the body. At first what happened? We ingest the food, we take in the food, then we undergo the process of digestion through the mouth. It starts with the mouth and it ends in the small intestine. Then the absorption takes place in the small intestine. Then what happens? Assimilation. Then that particular food is utilized or assimilated rather, so that it is easily available for the cells to take it. And then the last part of the thing, that is the ejection, that we give out the undigested part of the food out of our body. So this is what takes place, right? So now we are going to talk about the different parts of the digestive system. Now if I tell you that there are two parts of digestive system. What? The first part includes the alimentary canal itself, where that there are different organs which are participating, and the other part are the digestive glands or the enzymes which aid in the digestion of food. So, if I come to the alimentary canal, what is there? The alimentary canal, it includes the mouth, the pharynx, the esophagus, then we have the stomach, the small intestine and the large intestine, okay? And then of course, we have two more, if you want to add two more, that is then we have rectum and then we have the anus, right? And if I consider the other part of the digestive system, that is the digestive glands. It can be, if we start from the mouth, then at first we are having the salivary glands, then we are having the liver and the gallbladder, which not actively but passively participates in digestion. Then we have the gastric glands, which are present in our stomach. Then we include pancreas, then the glands of the small intestine. So these are the different parts of digestive system. So now we are moving on to the very first part of the digestive system, that is the mouth. Okay. Now, if we consider the mouth, or it is also known as the buccal cavity, at first we have to understand the positioning of the mouth, right, or what it is lined by on its surroundings. So, anteriorly, if we think, the mouth is lined by our lips, and if we are considering the posterior part of our mouth, then that is lined by, that is continuous to the esopharynx. Then if we look at lateral parts of the mouth, that includes our cheek muscles. Then if we include the superior part of the mouth or the upper part of the mouth, that includes the palate. Now this palate can be of two types, that is the hard palate and the soft palate. The hard part is the exact, the vertical portion or the anterior portion of the palate. That is the hard, if I show you through this, if I show through this, now if you see this anterior part of the mouth, the anterior part of the mouth, this is the hard palate and the posterior part of the mouth, it is softer. So that is the soft palate, okay? And if we are going to the inferior part of the mouth, so the inferior part of the mouth is having this tongue, okay? So this is all about, and another thing we should remember, that is the uvula. What is the uvula? Uvula is basically a muscle which is this part, it is actually a fold of muscle, carved fold of muscles, and it is lined by mucous membrane. So that is known as the uvula, okay? Now next we are moving to the tongue, okay? So if we are moving to the tongue, then we have to understand the positioning of the tongue or the location of the tongue or how is it attached. The tongue is basically attached by the hyoid bone, which is present over here somewhere in the, I cannot show you that, but it is actually connected to the hyoid bone and to the frenulum. Frenulum is, I would request you to give on the next slide. I hope you can see. So if you are considering this, this is the tongue, right? This is the tongue. Now if you are considering the tongue, it is having lots of small projections or very minute projections inside the tongues. They are known as the papillae. And these papillae, they generally have or they generally possess the taste buds or the nervous endings or the nerve endings which are present over there, which receive the signal of the taste, and that is why we feel different kind of taste in our tongue, right? So there are three types of papillae. What are the different types of papillae? One is the valate papillae, the other one is the filiform papillae, and the last part is the fungiform papillae, okay? Now, if you see the positioning, different types of papillae are present in different parts of the tongue. So, when we are considering about the fungiform papillae, they are present in the anterior part of the tongue. And yes, they are present in the anteriormost part of the tongue. Okay. Now, if we consider the filiform papillae, they are present in the two-third part of the, just behind the fungiform papillae, we find the filiform papillae. And the largest ones are present inside the, near the base of the tongue, and we can easily see them. If we open our mouth, if you open your mouth and you see yourself in the mirror, then you can definitely see this larger papillae, which are known as the valate papillae. Okay? So, I'll move on to this. That is what I have written, that it is attached to the hyoid bone and the frenulum. Frenulum is nothing but a fold of muscle, which is you can say, actually this is the frenulum. This is the frenulum, which is actually a part of muscle which is holding the tongue, and it is also lined by mucous membrane. Okay. So next, what we are telling, I told you that the mouth, the tongue has various minute projections which are called as papillae, and these papillae, they can be of three types. One is the valate papillae, that is the largest, and they are present at the base of the tongue. Then we are having the filiform papillae, which are the smallest, and they are present in the anterior, not exactly anterior most, but behind it. And the last part is the fungiform papillae, which are the smallest, and they are present in the anterior part of the tongue. Next, we are coming to the next part that is present inside our mouth, and we know that is teeth, which is basically helping in the grinding of the food, right? So we have to know that in case of us, we are having heterodont dentition. That means we are having different types of teeth. There are four types of teeth we know. So that is heterodont dentition. And there is another form of dentition which is known as the homodont dentition, which we do not possess. But there are certain fishes like the sharks. They possess the homodont dentition, where all the everything, they do not have different types of teeth. They have only one type of teeth, right? So that is homodont dentition. So now we have to move to the detailed structure of teeth. So I will concentrate over here. So this is a basic drawing or diagram of a basic tooth. So what are the different parts of the tooth? As you can see, the part which is protruding, which is visible rather, the part of the teeth that is visible, that part is known as the crown. That is the whitish yellow, the yellowish white part. That is known as the crown. And the part which is present inside our gum, that is known as the root. Okay? Now we are coming to the different parts of the crown. Or there are the different layers which are present inside the teeth. The very first layer, is known as the enamel, which is the whitish part. That is the enamel. Then we are having the dentine. Then we have the pulp cavity. Inside the pulp cavity, we are having the nervous endings and the blood vessels. This part. So these are the different parts of the tooth when we are considering it from the upper part. Now when we are moving to the inside part, then we will see the outer part is the cementum, which lines the root, the outermost part of the root, that is the cementum, and inside we are having similar layers. Now I'll move on to this part. Where we will see that the first part, I told you, the crown, which is protruding from the gum, the part of the teeth that is present, that we can see. Next, we have the root that is present inside or embedded in the bone. That is embedded inside the bone. Then we have the neck. The neck is actually this part. This part is known as the neck. Okay. Next, we are having the pulp cavity, which is this part, which has the nervous endings and the blood vessels. Next, we are having the dentine, which is the part surrounding the pulp cavity. That is, this pulp cavity is surrounded by this layer, which is known as the dentine. Then we have the enamel, which is the outermost part of outside, which is present outside the dentine. That is the enamel. Then we have cementum, which is lining the outer part of the root. Okay, so this is it. Next, we are coming to the types of teeth. Now, in higher animals, there are four types of teeth. Okay, I have just given you a basic knowledge. So the first type of teeth, that is known as the incisor. After telling this, I will move on to the projector. It will be easier. So let me finish this first. The first part of the teeth, that is the incisor, which are the front, these front, we have four in each jaw. That means the front four teeth, they are known as the incisors, and they basically aid in biting away, biting something. Or when you give, suppose when you're eating a banana or an apple, then we generally use the incisors. Next, we are having the canine, which we have two in each jaw, that is one and two, and another one in the lower jaw, one and two. So what is the function of the canine? The canine is basically, we know that it is basically used for tearing flesh. That is why the carnivorous animals, they have larger and stronger canines. But since we do not tend to eat raw flesh, that is why our canine is not that strong. Next, we are having the premolars, which is four in each jaw. Okay. And then we are having the molars, which are six. Okay. So this totals to, if you are considering two jaws, then 4 2s are 8, 2 2s are 4, 4 2s are 8, and 6 2s are 12. When we add it up, then we have 32. That is, this is the permanent teeth. And we know that whenever a person grows from its childhood till the adult, there are two times the teeth grows in our mouth. That is, the first part is known as the milk teeth, which falls off after a certain age, and then we are coming to the permanent teeth, which generally stays. And this is another thing, the last molar, the very last molar, we know this, so I'll just repeat once again. The very last molar present in our mouth is the wisdom teeth, which shows off at a later stage of our life. Okay. Okay. Next, we are coming over here. If you see, this is the basically the mouth, this is our jaw, this is one jaw. Okay, so if I show you this, four, one 1, 2, 3, 4. These are the incisors. Then we are having 1 and 2. These are the canines. And then the first 2 and 2, 4. They are the premolars. And the last 3, they are the molars. And this last part, that is actually the wisdom teeth. Now I'll move on to this part of the projector, where we are. There is the certain diagrams of the different types of teeth is given. I would like you to just go through them. Okay, so that's it. Now we are starting our next organ, that is known as the pharynx. We don't have anything much to say about pharynx, so I'll just give you the basic 3 parts of pharynx. That is the nasopharynx. Then we have the oropharynx, and the last part is the laryngopharynx. Now all these types, these 3 parts of pharynx, they aid in the passage of food. They don't have any other such function in the direct process of digestion. Next we are coming to the food pipe, which is also known as the esophagus. Now we have to know this once, that esophagus is a part of the alimentary canal which does not involve in any kind of active digestion. That is, no enzyme is secreted in this part of the alimentary canal. Okay, so the esophagus is basically tube like. I just written in short, I hope it will be easier for you to listen. So these are tube like, and it is also called as a food pipe. And the upper and the lower, if I show you this part, so this is basically the pharynx. Okay, this is the larynx part, which we are coming down to the next part, the food pipe. So if we see this food pipe, the food pipe is actually having 2 types of sphincter muscles. Okay, one sphincter is present over here, and the other sphincter is present in the start of the stomach. Okay, so what are the names of the sphincters? What are sphincters basically? Sphincters are basically flaps of muscles which acts as doors. You can tell them that these are doors which, when opened, the food enters. Okay, and when they are closed, it does not allow the opposite movement of the food upwards. Okay, so the first part of the sphincter, that is known as the esophageal sphincter, that is the upper esophageal sphincter. And the next part, that is the cardiac sphincter, or we also can call it as the lower esophageal sphincter. So what happens in the first? First the food reaches the pharynx. Then what happens? The upper esophageal sphincter, it relaxes. That means the door opens. Now as the door opens, the food from the mouth enters the esophagus. Then what happens? Peristalsis. We know what peristalsis is. Peristalsis is the rhythmic contraction and relaxation of the esophagus, which helps or which aids in the proper passage of food. Then what happens? Then as it reaches the end point of the esophagus, and when it is on the verge of entering the stomach, that is the next part of the digestive system, what happens? The LES, or the lower esophageal sphincter, or the cardiac sphincter, it relaxes. So that door opens. Now then what happens? This food from the food esophagus now enters the mucus is obviously secreted, and the food enters the stomach. So in this way, the food actually passes from the mouth to the stomach with the help of the peristalsis and the rhythmic contraction and relaxation of the food pipe. Now we are coming to one of the most important organs of the digestive system, that is the stomach. Now the stomach, if we consider the structure of the stomach basically has 4 parts: the cardiac stomach, the fundus, the body, and the pylorus. Okay, now if I show you this figure, you will see this part is known as the cardiac stomach. Then we have this bulge, which is known as the fundus. Then this is the body, and this is the pylorus, that is connecting, that is the starting point of the next part of the next organ of the digestive system, that is known as the small intestine or the duodenum, the very first part. Okay, now what is the function of stomach? Stomach basically involves what? Stomach is that part of the digestive system which releases a specific type of juice, or it is lined by specific type of glands which are known as the gastric glands. Now these gastric glands, they release gastric juices, and there are certain other cells which I'll be discussing in the next chapter in details about the HCl release and from where it is released and what are the functions of HCl and the gastric juices and what kind of food do they help in the breakdown of. So that we are going to consider in the next video, but today we are going to learn in details about the structure of the stomach. Okay, so this is it. The stomach basically has four parts: the cardiac stomach, the fundus, the body and the pylorus. And the stomach has four layers. If I consider the layer of tissues which line the stomach, it is basically of considering or made up of four different layers. Okay, the first one is the serous layer, then we are having the thick muscular layer, then we have the submucous layer, and the last part is known as the mucus layer. Okay, so these are the four layers. We don't have to get into details of these different types of layer and their histology because that is not inside our syllabus. Now next we are coming to the function of the stomach, or we are going to just discuss about the basic. I've just given some points, I hope that will be enough for you. So the first part is the temporary storage. So that is definitely a point, because food is temporarily stored over here in this part before it goes to the next part of the digestive system, that is the small intestine. The next part is the chemical digestion. This is very important because stomach is the part where chemical digestion takes place. Why chemical digestion? Because it includes various types of enzymes, chemical enzymes like pepsin and all these different types, HCl, these are included, which are present. So that is why chemical digestion is mentioned over here. Next, we have the mechanical breakdown. Not only the chemical digestion, but it also includes the mechanical breakdown of the food. Okay, because the stomach also contracts and relaxes, which the muscles in this inside the stomach, it's a very highly muscular organ which helps in the churning of the food. Next, that is the limited absorption of water. Yes, this is why, because water is definitely absorbed in this part. Then we have the last but not the least, that is the non-specific defense against the microbes. This is very important because why? Because we know the stomach releases HCl or the acid, which is actively or passively killing the microbes and the bacteria which may have tended or entered our body. Okay, so that's it about stomach. Next we are going to move to small intestine. We have come to the penultimate form of the organ of the digestion, that is the small intestine. Now if we consider, first let me tell you, actually the entire GI tract has the four layers of tissues which I have told you earlier, right? So the intestinal lining or the small intestine is also lined by those four layers only, which I have discussed just a few minutes ago. Now we are going to come to the different parts of small intestine. Now small intestine is basically having three parts. What are those parts? The first part is the duodenum, that is the anterior part. If we consider this figure, so the stomach ends over here and the anterior part of the small intestine is the duodenum. Then we have the deeply carved part, which is the largest part of the small intestine, that is the jejunum. And the very last part of the small intestine is known as the ileum, which again continues to the large intestine. So what should I say is that when we are, what is the function of small intestine in general? Now small intestine plays a very important part in digestion because it releases number of enzymes in itself, and it is also the site where the pancreas releases its enzymes within it. That is, pancreas releases its enzyme inside the duodenum in order to aid in the digestion of specific type of food which we are going to talk about in the next video. So then what happens? Then this food enters this curvy part of the digestive system of the small intestine, that is the jejunum. And finally when it reaches the ileum, we know very well that inside the ileum there are very finger like projections which are known as the villi. And these villi or the finger like projections, they actually absorb the food. So this is very important that you note that the last part, actually in the small intestine, when the food enters the ileum, that means the entire process of digestion is complete. Okay, digestion of proteins, fats and lipids, sorry, protein, fats and carbohydrates, they are almost over. They are completely over. Now in the next part, that is the large intestine, none of the digestion will take place. Digestion is not taking place in the large intestine. Large intestine is only for absorption of water, reabsorption of water. So here what happens, so this villi, the very finger like projections, very minute finger like projections which are present inside the wall of the ileum, actually absorbs that simplest form of food that is now being produced, and that food will be taken to the cells for assimilation. Okay, so that is what I have written here. If we come over here, so what is written over here? Duodenum. It is the secretion of the gallbladder and the pancreas enter over here. And the next part, the jejunum, which is the largest part of the small intestine. And then we have the ileum, which is the last part, which has finger-like projections called villi. Now, what are the functions of small intestine? Digestion through intestinal juice. This is very important because not only intestinal juice, but also pancreatic juices. Then it helps in the absorption. This is the only part of this is the only part of digestive system where the absorption of food takes place, through villi. And it is the large part where the digestion takes place. That means in the small intestine, the digestion of food or the breaking down is completely over. Now it has to be absorbed and the undigested part has to be released. So that next part will be the large intestine, where what will happen? We will not see any kind of digestive process going over there, but only reabsorption of water. Okay, last part of the digestive system, that is the large intestine. I have told you earlier that large intestine is the part of the digestive system which does not include any kind of digestive enzymes. It is only having functions such as absorption, reabsorption of water and nutrients, and there are a number of functions which I'll be discussing later. So let us first move on to the structure of the large intestine. Now again I would like to tell that I have already told you in case of small intestine and large intestine that the entire GI tract has four layers of tissues. The same goes for large intestine, and the large intestine has basically three parts. That is the first part of the large intestine, that is known as the cecum. Then we have the colon. Then the colon has four different parts. And then we are having rectum, which is the last part of the large intestine. Now what happens in the cecum part? It is the first part of the digestive system and it has a blind end. Now I would move from here to this photo. I hope you can see. So this is basically the start of the large intestine. So where the large intestine starts, we can see that there is a blind end. And this blind end, that this is where the appendix, the vestigial organ in humans, the appendix is present over here. Now, is it, we know that the appendicitis takes place when this part of the organ or the appendix, it enlarges, okay? And if we don't operate it timely, then it can burst. So that may lead to the death of the patient. So this is actually the appendix, which is present in the first part of the large intestine, that is the cecum. Now what happens? This cecum part will continue to the next part. This entire part, the largest part of the large intestine is the colon, which is again divided into a number of parts, into four parts rather, okay? Now when the cecum starts, then we have this ascending loop, the ascending. Why ascending? Because it is moving upwards. So this ascending loop of the large intestine is known as the ascending colon. Okay, this is known as the ascending colon, which moves up, and then this lateral part, or which is moving like this, this is the transverse colon. Then again it is descending downwards, so this part is the descending colon, and the last part, this last part of the colon is known as the sigmoid colon, which ultimately leads to the last part of the large intestine, that is the rectum. Okay. So here what happens? Here basically the food passes through the ascending colon, the transverse colon, the descending colon, and the sigmoid colon. This is the cecum. So then comes the ascending colon, then this is the transverse colon, and then the last part of the colon, that is the descending colon. Then we are having a very small part, that is known as the sigmoid colon, which empties itself, or this opens into the final part that is known as the rectum. So what is rectum? Rectum is basically the place where the undigested part of the food is stored temporarily, okay, before getting inside the last part of the digestive system, that is the anus. So we'll move on to this part where I have written that cecum, the first part, and it is a dilated part. So dilated means it is a bulgy, it's a bit bulgy. So dilated part and has a blind end, and this is the part where the vermiform appendix is present, the vestigial organ in humans. Then we have the colon. I told you that there are four parts or four parts of colon. The first part is the ascending colon, then we have the transverse one, then we have the descending one, and the last part is the sigmoid colon, which connects itself to the last part of the small intestine, that is the rectum. So it is the last part. It is also a bit bulgy and a dilated part, and it stores the undigested part of the food temporarily. Now what happens? We'll come to the functions of large intestine, which includes what I told you, that it basically involves the reabsorption of water and other nutrients. Nutrients like minerals and salts and everything, they are reabsorbed in this part. Then what happens? Vitamin K and folic acid is actually synthesized in this part. Why? Because there are certain bacteria like E. coli which are present or which reside in this part of the large intestine, which aids in the synthesis of vitamin K and folic acid. And the last one, it aids in the peristaltic movement. That is, the peristaltic movement aids in the movement of the undigested food out of the body. And the last one is the defecation. This is the part where defecation takes place, that is the formation of stool, and it moves out. Then we are coming to the last part, that is the anus, which is the last and the outermost part of the digestive system, where what happens? It is a short passage that connects the rectum to the exterior of the body, and it has two types of sphincter muscles. Now here again we are coming to sphincter muscles. I have talked about sphincter muscles in stomach. Now we are coming to the sphincter muscles in anus, which is basically of two types. The internal sphincter muscle, that is actually under the control of the autonomic nervous system, and the other one is the external sphincter that has the voluntary control, so that the undigested part of the food can come out of the body in the form of stool. So here we come in the towards the end of this chapter, or this part of the video, and in the next part of the video we'll be discussing about the different digestive glands, and we are also going to talk about in details about the chemical process of digestion, or the how the in which part of the digestive system the different types of enzymes are released and what kind of functions do they possess. So thank you.
Thanks for watching. Leave a like and comment. Subscribe. And do share the video among your friends.